everyone, welcome to the next session of ANSYS tutorial. Today I am going to plot stress strain and force displacement curve for structural steel. I am solving for structural steel. You can solve for any other material. Let's get started with example 1. Okay, here I have 3 examples listed down. Today I am going to solve the first problem, which is my first video on stress strain curve. The second and the third one will be the 2 consecutive videos. Do keep an eye. Only when you watch all the 3 videos will you understand the difference between the all 3 of them. I will put 3 different cross sections for each of them so that it becomes easy for you to understand. And you also have a variety of problems then. So let's get started with example 1. For cantilever beam subjected to point load along the y-axis, we will have to plot the curve. You can see over here, this is the cantilever beam. One end is fixed, the other end is subjected to some amount of force. The length of the beam is L. I have written point load along y-axis because the beam is actually 1D here. Suppose if you have a 2D or a 3D structure, in that case you will have an edge or a surface coming into picture. I want to discuss about the curve which you are expected to obtain. If you look at this figure, this is the stress versus strain curve for structural steel. The blue curve is actually the true stress strain curve which is supposed to be obtained. But due to the spring back action in the material or due to the various property of the material, we get this red curve over here. So when I am supposed to obtain this red curve from this point, which is 0, up to this end, I'll just show you. You can see this point. So this much portion which you see over here is going to be my elastic zone. And what you see over here is going to be my plastic zone. So this is my plastic zone, this is my elastic zone. So from this 0 to this point here, what you get is a straight line, whether it is a true stress strain curve or it is the actual curve which I am supposed to obtain. And after this point 2 till this point 3, in both the cases you get a particular curve. So this is the kind of structure that I am supposed to obtain, wherein half portion is elastic and the other portion is plastic. Within the elastic zone, the material follows Hooke's law, which means the stress will be directly proportional to the strain. But in this plastic zone, there is a non-linearity coming into picture. The stress and strain are not directly proportional. So it is possible that the stress will increase and the strain will remain the same. It is possible that without the increase of stress, the strain will still be there in the material, which happens over here. And after that, what happens is suddenly the stress is going to increase to a particular value. So this point over here is going to be my ultimate stress over here. And then finally at this point 3, at both of them, what we see is rupture. So after rupture, the force again comes back to 0 and the stress obviously will be 0 in that case, because no load can be applied in that case. So this is how the stress strain curve should be. From this you have understood that the material has little bit of non-linearity in it. Now let's go to ANSYS. I will be using static structural. I will rename it as example 1. First we'll go to engineering data. This general material structural steel is a linear material. Now in this, if you look carefully, the Young's modulus value is given. If I want to read in megapascal, it is 2 into 10 raised to 5 megapascal, which is given here. In this case, what happens is the material is completely elastic. If you read here, it is given isotropic elasticity. If you use this steel, you will only get graph up to this point. But for this portion of the graph, this material cannot be used. So I need to induce something which is called as plasticity, as you see to the left in the toolbox. I can use either bilinear isotropic hardening or I can use multilinear isotropic hardening. Now, what is the difference between both of them? In bilinear isotropic hardening, what happens is, in this particular graph, from 2 to 3, the maximum number of points which is obtained is only 1. So, you have just 1 point to draw this curve. Whereas in multilinear, what happens is, you find various points and those points are going to actually indicate the slope of that line. So, because of various slope, you get a little different curve. This curve is not of multilinear, but this is just of bilinear. Suppose if you have multilinear, your curve will become little bit more wavy. So that's just the difference. So either you can induce the property of bilinear or multilinear and create structural steel and use that material, or you can do one more thing. In engineering data sources, you can just go to general nonlinear material. ANSYS by default has already created many nonlinear materials. Amongst that, structural steel is one. If you click on it, I've added structural steel. Now when I go to filter engineering data, I can see nonlinear material. In nonlinear material, bilinear isotropic hardening is added, for which the yield strength in megapascal is given as 250 and the tangent modulus is given as 1450. So these are the two properties which are required for bilinear isotropic hardening property. So I have chosen structural steel nonlinear. I'll go back to my project and I will refresh my project. I don't need structural steel, so I'm directly refreshing my project. Now I'll go to geometry, right click, new design model of geometry. Okay, we are going to draw very simple geometry. I'll go to units, millimeter, XY, look at. First, I'll start with our basic shape or rectangle. I'll give some dimensions to it. It's a random dimensioning of a beam. Say I'll take 35 and here I'll take 30. Extrude. I'll extrude for say 400 mm. Generate. I have to make sure that the length or the span of the beam is quite larger as compared to the cross section of the beam. This is one of the structural difference between a beam or any other element. So geometry is done. I'll double click on model now. This is the screen for model. I'll first go to geometry, solid. I'll change structural steel to structural steel nonlinear. I'll go to mesh, sizing. Coarse will be changed to fine. Update. Next, I'll go to static structural. I first align my body. On one end, I'll insert fixed support. On this edge, if you see the figure, on the edge, I'll apply force. Rather than vector, I'll choose component. I'll take the value of force as -7000. Okay, now I'll go to analysis settings. In this problem, we are going to use multi steps as well. So number of steps I'll change to 2. In program control, from this option auto time setting, I'll change it to on. I want to give number of substeps in this problem from my end. Say I want to give 30, 30 and 100. Next, what I'll do is, there is an option of large deflection. Put it to on, because there will be little larger deflections in this case. They all need to be captured, and these are the number of, you know, substeps you will have. So more number of readings will get incorporated in your solution. So it is actually better. Now I want to show one more thing over here, that is of force. Here I'll change the value of force from -7000 to 0. In two steps, what I'm doing is, I'm giving a loading and unloading kind of feature. So 0 to -7000 to 0.
If you have seen an UTM where you perform the tensile test, bending test or any other type of test, you generally go for a loading and unloading process. So that's what I'm doing over here with the help of this two steps. Now I'll go to solution and I'll first solve. Here I'll make one change. I'll go to solution information and rather than solver output, I'll go for force convergence. I can see over here like at what time my force is going to get converged. So the time is shown below and I can also see my force. It'll take a little longer duration because we have used fine mesh. We are using non-linear analysis. We are using loading unloading condition and also we have given many number of steps over here. So because of these four conditions, it will take a little longer duration as compared to our other static structural problems. So you can see at minus 7000 Newton, my force has converged here. And I'll go to solution, right click, insert, stress, equivalent Von Mises. Right click, insert, strain, equivalent total. Right click, insert, deformation, total. Because I also want to plot a graph of force versus deformation. Or displacement as you would say. So I'll go to solution again and solve. Now once you have already run the solution without these options, it is much easier to get the solution when you have these options, because with these options if you go for solving the entire problem at once, what happens is your computation time keeps on increasing. So I just solved first and then I went for obtaining these. So this is my equivalent stress diagram over this body, you can see over here. I will just play the animation so you can see the equivalent stress here. Okay, you can see the maximum value of equivalent stress is obtained at this point and minimum over here. The maximum stress which is obtained is 360 megapascal. Now I just want to show you something. When I go to my engineering data and I go to structural steel non-linear, the yield strength is going to be 250 if you see over here. Now if you also click on this, you can get this graph of stress strain. So this is the kind of stress strain bilinear graph that you're supposed to obtain. This is the value of 250 megapascal and after that you can see the failure part of it. So this is well above your 250 value. Okay, if you want to change the number of frames and see 30 frames, so you can see a little faster view how the breaking takes place. So I'll just go up to 10 seconds and I'll increase the frames. So this is how you can see the failure, which is very slow. Okay, I'll just save this video from here. It will be saved as a .avi file. We'll go to total strain over here now. You can see the strain curve over here. I'll just play the animation again. This shows you the strain in that material. Okay, if you want to get the maximum minimum value, it's very much obtained over here. I'll go to deformation. The maximum deformation obviously will be at this point. So this is how you see the deformation. Now I need to plot some more things. The first thing that I'll go for is insert stress equivalent. I will plot the equivalent stress somewhere over here. So I'll just choose the node where I want to get the equivalent stress. And at the same point, I also want to calculate the total equivalent strain. So I'll just solve for this. So I've got the stress and the strain over there. Next what I'll do is I have to plot the chart. So this is the chart option over here, new chart and table. So I'll click on this. From here you can see there's an outline selection. I'll click here first. Now what are the two properties you need for making of the chart that you need to select? For example, first click on force, then I'll hold the control button and I will select total deformation. and apply. So both the quantities have been selected. You can see there are two objects here. Next I'll go to x-axis. On x-axis I want to see my deformation maximum, because it is force versus deformation. These things can be left the way it is. On x-axis you can label it, say I want deformation or displacement, whatever term you want to use. On the y-axis I want the force. So these are the two terms which I can see. Next I'll go to time. I don't want to display time at all, so I'll just omit time. You can also double click on it to omit. Force x-axis I don't need. Z-axis force is not required. I only want the y-axis force. And for display over here in the output quantities, this minimum value of deformation is not required. I only want the maximum deformation. So this is the kind of force versus deformation graph which you can see I'm getting here. Now if you want, I can do one more thing, that is I can have directional deformation. I'll change it to y-axis and solve. I'll just do one thing, I'll create one more chart, that'll be better. So I'll just choose force, directional deformation, apply. X-axis I have directional deformation max. Here I write deformation in y-axis, and here I'll write force time. I'll omit x-axis, omit z-axis, omit, and this also is not required. So this is the kind of graph I'm getting. So you can see it's nearly the same, but there's just little difference of values. So this is what I'm going to get. Okay, I can just insert one more thing, probe force reaction at fixed end, solve. And I can just make a chart. Apply. So if you want to see a force reaction versus deformation graph, you'll see something like this. It's just going to be positive as compared to the other one, because it's obviously opposite in direction. Anyways, I'll go to the next chart that I require, that is stress versus strain, most important. I'll take up this equivalent stress 2 and total strain 2, apply. X-axis I want to plot strain. X-axis is strain. Y-axis is stress. Time not needed. Equivalent stress minimum not needed. Stress maximum required. Minimum omit. This is my stress versus strain graph for the structural steel subjected to the load of minus 7000 Newton in the y-axis. So this is how you plot the stress strain curve for a particular material. I hope you have understood the problem. If you have any doubt, do let me know in the comment section. Don't forget to like, share and subscribe to my channel. See you in the next session with the second part of this video. Thank you.